people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with India-Sri Lanka bilateral ties that received a fresh impetus with Indian Foreign Minister S. Jaishankar's visit to the island nation. The visit that came just 3 months after the virtual prime ministerial summit between the two countries focused at improving ties comprehensively. India has also committed to fulfill Sri Lanka's vaccine needs.
India-Sri Lanka ties have been moving north, especially in the past few months. The two countries have renewed their cooperation in almost all sectors, including the issue of trade, fisheries and Tamil rights. On his recent visit to the island nation, Indian External Affairs Minister Subramaniam Jaishankar outlined the growth and prosperity two countries could achieve with each other's support. Both sides committed to further enhance the works in maritime security. The statements come at a time when Chinese firm behind the controversial Hambantota port has bagged a $1 billion contract to develop Sri Lanka's port city. After struggling for years to pay off the debts on Hambantota port, Sri Lanka had to lease the port and an additional 60.7 square kilometers of land around it to China for 99 years. While New Delhi's neighborhood first policy makes Colombo an automatic priority for India, the island nation too has been striving to establish a firm bond between the two.
During our talks, we focused on multiple areas of mutual cooperation in the identified sectors of the economy, finance, trade, commerce, defense, security and fisheries, cultural, and particularly on the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic and the post-COVID era that we are moving in.
An increased engagement at the highest levels of leadership has restored the strength between the two nations, which had suffered few hiccups following China's increased intervention in the country's affairs that ended up in Colombo's massive loss. While New Delhi and Colombo are mulling extending cooperation in the fields of energy and infrastructure, the two sides have already carved out a solution for the fisherman issue. Both countries have agreed on certain practical agreements to deal with the issue of bona fide fishermen of either side crossing the international maritime boundary line. After following a Chinese submarine to be parked in its waters, Sri Lanka has said that it will not allow its strategic location to be used against India and will cooperate with New Delhi to further improve security for India. Both countries believe that such moves could improve ties at multiple levels.
As two close neighbors with such obvious synergies, the potential for further strengthening our cooperation is enormous. Some of that may help provide immediate relief. Others would have very positive medium-term implications for Sri Lanka's development. There are many proposals under discussion, including in infrastructure, energy, and connectivity. Their early implementation is obviously in our mutual interest and would definitely accelerate Sri Lanka's economic recovery. Let me also stress that Indian business is strongly interested in investing in Sri Lanka. We have discussed some important opportunities in the course of yesterday and today, including in special zones for pharmaceutical manufacturing, as also in tourism.
The ties between the two have been decades old and hold a potential of growing at a rapid rate. Trade between the two countries has grown particularly rapidly after the entry into force of the India-Sri Lanka Free Trade Agreement in March 2000. Bilateral trade in 2018 amounted to $4.93 billion. Exports from India to Sri Lanka in 2018 were $4.16 billion, while exports from Sri Lanka to India are $767 million. Sri Lanka is among the major recipients of development assistance from Government of India. The Indian Housing Project, with an initial commitment to build 50,000 houses for the war-affected as well as the state workers in the plantation area, is Government of India's flagship project of developmental assistance to Sri Lanka. India says it is committed to see a strong neighbourhood, and Sri Lanka is one of its top priority.
Moving on. In what would be one of the biggest in the world, India is set to roll out its massive vaccine inoculation drive. The country's drug controller has authorized restricted emergency use to Oxford and Serum Institute's Covishield and Bharat Biotech's Covaxin. The central government has been supervising dry run across the country and says it will launch the process any day after it is assured of safety of vaccine, seamless transportation.
India has readied some 29,000 cold storage facilities across the country, and large-scale inoculation dry runs are being conducted before the government rolls out the vaccines that have already been approved by the country's regulator. Country has approved two COVID-19 vaccines for emergency use, Covishield, developed by AstraZeneca, and homegrown Covaxin, backed by Bharat Biotech. It plans to roll out a vaccination program by next week, aiming to cover 300 million people by July.
Two vaccines, jinka naam Covishield hai aur Covaxin hai, ye desh ke liye उपलब्ध होने की स्थिति में आ गई हैं और हमारी कोशिश ये है कि एकदम बिना किसी रुकावट के, जिसे कहते हैं कि सीमलेस लास्ट माइल डिलीवरी इन वैक्सीन्स की, हम सारे देश में उस स्थान तक पहुंचा दें जहां पर हमको अपने फर्स्ट फेज के अंदर हमारे को किस प्रकार से जो अपने प्रायोरिटी ग्रुप्स हैं उनको वैक्सीनेशन देना है.
Under the current plan, vaccines will be first delivered by manufacturers to four key storage facilities at Mumbai, Chennai, Kolkata and Karnal, and then moved to 37 state-level stores. India's primary vaccine storage facilities, including the ones at Chennai and Mumbai, are all set to become the hubs for mass storage for country's mega vaccination drive against coronavirus, expected to start from next week.
51 locations we have created, new walk-in coolers which can store up to 2.5 crore vaccines. And today I also inspected the Government of India's drug store. You know, we have a central government thing where they have both the dry storage and also the regular vaccine storage. They are ready to receive the supplies as and when the Government of India gives its transportation schedule.
The shots will be systematically transported by road to hundreds of districts, where local officials will vaccinate pre-registered healthcare workers at designated facilities. The government has already prioritized the citizens who will be vaccinated in the first phase of the drive. From the healthcare workers to people with comorbidities have been earmarked as people in emergent need of the vaccine doses. Authorities and people responsible for transporting the vaccine till the last mile say they are confident of the successful drive.
ये कोई भी temperature को transport कर सकती है, चाहे वो -80 हो या +2 to 8 degrees हो, और ये vaccine को वो temperature पे कम से कम 5 दिन तक रख सकती है, जब बाहर का तापमान 43 degrees constant है, तो ये तो कभी भी possible नहीं है कि दिन और रात 43 degrees रहेगा. तो मेरे हिसाब से ये आसानी से इंडिया में 10 दिन तक किसी भी वैक्सीन को स्टोर और ट्रांसपोर्ट कर सकती है, और ये हमारे लिए इंडिया में बहुत बड़ा सलूशन होने वाला है.
The government, however, has said that people are required to be extra careful until the vaccination, especially after the outbreak of the mutant coronavirus. The government's efforts and messages have been effective in the past as India, which was registering around 100,000 cases every day during its peak in mid-September, has brought it down to around 20,000 cases per day. The World Health Organization, which has lauded government's commitment, is also looking forward to country's vaccination program, which it says will not only help Indians, but will help fight the rest of the world, especially the poor countries.
Moving on, dissent is the most despised word and phenomenon in Pakistan. To say precisely, it is prohibited. You risk getting doomed if you dissent against the government. Even a hint of opposition can land you in trouble. The establishment takes dissenters down, no matter where on earth they are. Karima Baloch was their latest hunt. However, it hasn't been an easy getaway for Islamabad this time. The Balochs have stepped up their demonstrations and are asking the international community, including Canada, where the crime happened, to have an intensive inquiry and investigation. The chorus has resonated with political observers, and even they are calling her death a foul play.
Baloch grief and outrage is spreading rapidly across the countries. A number of Baloch activists held a demonstration in front of the Canadian High Commission in Paris to demand justice in the alleged murder of renowned activist Karima Baloch. They raised freedom slogans and asked for a thorough investigation into what has thus far been treated an unsuspicious death by Canadian police. Baloch say they want Ottawa to look deep into the issue, not only because Karima died in that country, but also because Pakistan is trying hard to erase the evidence and peddle a false narrative.
To be investigated, the context of it has to be put into place. We need to look at all the threats. Hamal, Karima Baloch's husband, has been demanding from the police that the police should be giving more information than just saying that they concluded it as a suicide. That cannot be concluded so quickly.
Pakistan's dubious design of cracking down on Baloch dissent, or for that matter any dissent, involves arresting activists on trumped-up charges and subjecting them to inhuman torture in detention centres. They are imprisoned incommunicado for indefinite period of time. On most occasions, they never return to home. There have been over 50,000 cases of disappearances in Balochistan so far. The barbarity has only gained strength with time as the establishment-backed coons attack innocents with impunity. The regional parties have withdrawn their support from Imran Khan's government on the issue of disappearances, but Khan, who's accused of taking orders from army generals, has appeared least bothered. And now, the chapter of Karima Baloch, an overseas killing, has added a fresh component to their satanic plots to cleanse all those who expose Pakistan's deep-rooted bias for Baloch.
She was asking why the Baloch are deprived of our freedom, why the Baloch are not having our sovereign land, why our land is occupied by the Pakistani Islamic forces, why our land is occupied by an Islamic country. The occupation of Pakistan by Pakistan is against the will of the Baloch people. For that, she was raising her voice there at Balochistan, at Quetta University, at press clubs of Balochistan, at press clubs of Karachi, at press club of Islamabad. But she was threatened, and for life safety, she came to Canada to and she was living there as a refugee.
Karima wasn't the first or the last to have been targeted abroad. while Sajid Hussain, a journalist, was founded in similar fashion in Sweden last year. Only recently, Rahat Austin, a Park-born lawyer, author and an activist who has been a vocal critique of Islamabad's human rights violations against the minorities, was attacked with knife.
I just personally report the incident of persecution, the constant and severe kind of persecution, apartheid, genocide and systematic ethnic cleansing, which is government and this Muslim majority population is doing like religious obligation, like jihad against the non-Muslims. We were 23% when Pakistan was made about 70 years ago in 1947, but now we are just left 3%. We are, you know, it's a systematic genocide, and because of controlled media and government policy to hide such atrocities, nobody just report that.
Islamabad's modus operandi has been to muzzle the voice of dissent permanently. It never pursued a legal or democratic process in any case to counter what the dissenters said. The truth is, it does not have an argument. While some say the country's leadership has been baffled by the everyday decline in its reputation owing to exposé done by the activists, others believe that it is China that is controlling and directing Pakistan's actions. It doesn't want to see a politically unstable Pakistan where it is investing over $65 billion. Some observers say that the genesis of an abrupt and systematic violence against Balochs of late is also associated with Chinese agenda in the region. It has been aggressively developing infrastructure on land of Balochs. The Baloch resistance has met with brute violence, disappearances and killings of activists inside and outside of what they call their sovereign territory.
Moving on, protests have erupted in the illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan, where the engineering department of the Karakoram International University was burned down overnight by the goons. Observers say these extremists are backed by the administration. This isn't the first incident of such violence where an institution has been targeted by the extremists. Pakistan has systematically targeted the education system in the illegally occupied regions as it believes educated and informed youth will pose a threat to their illegal occupation.
These protesting youths are engineering aspirants of the illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan whose dreams were quashed overnight. The under-construction engineering department of the Karakoram International University was set on fire by some unknown goons, depriving them of technical education and a better future. Both students and the administrative staff of the university have demanded a thorough investigation and expedite justice into the issue.
हम कराकोरम इंटरनेशनल यूनिवर्सिटी के एम्प्लॉइज की तरफ से अपना गम और गुस्से का इजहार करते हैं और गवर्नमेंट को से यह गुजारिश करते हैं कि वो मुजरिमों को जल्द से जल्द पकड़ ले और तालीमी इदारे को मजीद नुकसान होने से बचाए क्योंकि हम ये खदशा हमारा है हम समझते हैं कि शायद ये इसी तरह करते करते
This incident is not the first or an isolated incident of this nature. Educational institutes have been targeted time and again by the extremists who are allegedly backed by Islamabad. In August 2018, around a dozen schools were burned down overnight in the Diamar district of the region.
इतने बड़े इदारे को जलाने के बाद यूनिवर्सिटी की इंतजामिया यूनिवर्सिटी के स्टूडेंट्स और यूनिवर्सिटी के एडमिन के ऑफिसर्स ये खतरा फील कर रहे हैं कि कल को हो सकता है ये लोग यूनिवर्सिटी के अंदर ना आ जाएं। ये एक ऐसा गैर मामूली वाक़ा है कि मेरे ख्याल में गुमू की हिस्ट्री में ऐसे वाक़ात तालीमी इदारे जलाने वाले, चंद साल पहले स्कूल जलाए गए थे जामीर में जो है ये इदारे लोरथांगीर में, उसके बाद ये गिलगित शहर के बगल में शहर के अंदर ही ये इदारा था जिसमें गिलगित बल्टिस्तान के बच्चों ने पढ़ना था।
The literacy rate of the illegally occupied regions of Gilgit-Baltistan and POK is higher than Pakistan's national average. In the past, locals have accused the Pakistan government of systematically denying people of Gilgit-Baltistan education that can help them grow into an employable lot. Observers have also said in the past that a backward and unstable occupied region is in Islamabad's interest as it can exploit it with little effort.
इनको पकड़कर इनको जेलों में डालकर उनके खिलाफ सजा दी जाए। आज तालीमी इदारों के ऊपर हमला हुआ है, कल अस्पतालों के ऊपर होगा, तीसरे दिन किसी और जगह पे होगा। इन बुजुर्गों को बेलगाम न किया जाए, उनको लगाम देना चाहिए, उनको पकड़ के सजा देनी चाहिए। हम ये पुरजोर मुजम्मत करते हैं, पुरामन इल्तिजा करते हैं गवर्नमेंट से कि तालीमी इदारों के अंदर कम से कम इस किस्म के घिनौनी हरकतें बंद की जाए।
The deep state of Pakistan Army is virtually in charge of all affairs of Gilgit-Baltistan and POK. The Army General devises political policies and implements them. Observers say they are the one behind such anonymous attacks in the region, as they sense a potential of a rebellion in people who are informed and educated. Nipping their aspiration in the bud has been the modus operandi and a successful policy thus far.
Moving on. Nestled in the Pir Panjal range in a cup-shaped valley, Gulmarg town in India's Jammu and Kashmir has been specially touched by nature's splendid hand. During winters, it turns out to be a major tourist destination as people start flocking here to enjoy snowfall and participate in winter sports like alpine skiing, snow cycling, sledge race and more. Let's visit this beautiful place.
Nature has endowed Kashmir with implausible beauty and is rightly called as paradise on earth. The Kashmir Valley remains a major tourist attraction during all the seasons. A large number of people throng snow-covered peaks of Gulmarg to enjoy winter sports. Adventure enthusiasts take part in the adventure sports like ice skating, skiing, gliding and racing.
कई दिनों से ये इंतज़ार कर रहे थे कि इस तरह एक साथ में इतनी तमाम गेम्स का इनॉग्रेशन कब होगा। अलग अलग स्टेट से कई सारे प्लेयर्स आप देख रहे हैं, यंग प्लेयर्स आए हुए हैं जो यहाँ पर इस सीज़न में ये चाहते हैं कि कश्मीर में उन्हें मौका मिले कि वो अपना जलवा दिखाएं एंड स्केयर हो, या तमाम वो लोग जो विंटर स्पोर्ट्स से जुड़े हुए हैं आज वो अलग अलग स्टेट से यहाँ पर आए हुए हैं और उन्हें वेलकम किया जा रहा है। और ओवरऑल इसका सबसे बड़ा मैसेज ये है कि जो हमारा कश्मीर का टूरिज़्म है वो उसे बूस्ट किया जा रहा है। सो ये एक अच्छा साइन है सर।
Winter Games are an extension of the carnival organized by the J&K Tourism Department on the occasion of New Year, as it helps attract more tourists amid the COVID-19 pandemic. As the temperature dips during winters, water bodies freeze into ice, which provides a favorable space for winter sports and other activities.
इस साल जो फिर से यहाँ पे जेके टूरिज्म ने विंटर गेम्स का जो यहाँ पे इनेकाद किया है, ये हमारे लिए बहुत फ़ायदे की बात है। यहाँ के जो यूथ है, खासकर जो गुलमर्ग में आजकल काम कर रहे हैं, उनको इससे बड़ा एक्सपोजर मिलेगा।
स्नोफॉल इन कैपिटल श्रीनगर आल्सो ब्रॉट चीयर्स टू द टूरिस्ट हु ट्रिकल्ड इन फ्रॉम डिफरेंट पार्ट्स ऑफ द कंट्री। The city was covered in white, with snow adding to the beauty of the iconic Dal Lake, much to the delight of the tourists who are seen playing in the snow.
Indeed, Gulmarg is a wonderland for adventure sports lovers. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye, take care, and stay safe.